Hey friends, welcome to the YouTube channel All About Electronics. So in this video, we will see the small signal analysis of the differential amplifier. And with the help of the small signal analysis, we will find the gain of this differential amplifier. So in the previous video, through a large signal analysis, we found the operating range of this differential input. And then we also found the relationship between this differential input and the differential output. So to get the exact relationship between the differential output and the differential input, we just need to multiply this expression by the minus RD. But anyway, as you can see this expression, here the relationship between this input and output is nonlinear. So if we want to use this differential pair as an amplifier, then this input Vin1 minus Vin2 or this differential input should be very small. So in that condition, this relationship between this input and output will become linear. So in the previous video, we also found the condition for this small signal approximation. That means whenever this differential input Vin1 minus Vin2 is much less than 2 times V overdrive, then under this small signal approximation, this term can be neglected and this ID1 minus ID2 can be written like this. Now if we further rearrange this term and if we take this 4 outside, then it will become 2 and it will get cancelled with this 2. So eventually, this is how the equation will look like. And of course, this differential output VO1 minus VO2 is equal to minus RD times this ID1 minus ID2. That is equal to minus RD times square root of mu n times COx times this W divided by L times ISS times Vin1 minus Vin2. So now if you see, then for the given differential pair, this mu n times COx times this W by L is fixed. That means for the given bias current ISS, this entire square root term will remain fixed. And therefore, under this small signal approximation, the relationship between this differential output and the differential input is now linear. So under this small signal approximation, whenever this differential input is very small, then we can use this small signal analysis and with the help of it, we can find the gain of this differential amplifier. So now as you know, the input to this differential amplifier consists of two components, that is common mode component and the differential component. So for the small signal analysis, all the DC sources and the common mode input will be considered as zero. That means here, this common mode input VCM will act as a zero, while this ideal current source will also act as an open circuit. Moreover, this voltage source VDD will act as a short circuit and it will get connected to the ground terminal. And now, for the small signal analysis, we need to replace these MOSFETs by their small signal model. So after the replacement, if we see the small signal equivalent circuit, then it will look like this. So here, this differential input is applied between the gate and the ground terminal, while the drain resistor RD will appear between the drain and the ground terminal. Now here, these currents ID1 and the ID2 are the small signal currents, or in other words, they are the change in the drain currents due to the differential inputs. So this change in the drain current ID1 can be given as this GM1 times VGS1. Similarly, this current ID2 can be given as GM2 times VGS2. And here, this VGS1 and the VGS2 are the change in the gate to source voltage due to these differential inputs. So now, let's say this node is equal to X and the voltage at this node is equal to Vx. Now if these two MOSFETs are perfectly matched, then for a small signal differential input, the voltage Vx will not change and this node X will act as a ground terminal. And if that is the case, then the analysis of this circuit will become very easy. So first of all, let us prove that this node indeed acts as a ground for this small differential input. And for that, let us apply the KVL on this left hand side. So if we apply the KVL, then we can write this voltage VID1 minus VGS1 is equal to Vx. Similarly, if we apply the KVL on this right hand side, then we can write this voltage VID2 minus VGS2 that is equal to Vx. So if we equate these two expressions, then we can say that this VID1 minus VGS1 that is equal to this VID2 minus VGS2, or we can say that this VID1 minus VID2 that is equal to this VGS1 minus VGS2. And let's say this is the equation number 1. So now let us apply the KCL at this node. So if you see, then at this node, this drain current ID1 and the ID2 are the incoming drain currents. So we can say that this ID1 plus ID2 is equal to 0. Now this ID1 is equal to GM1 times VGS1. Similarly, this ID2 is equal to GM2 times VGS2. So we can say that this GM1 times VGS1 plus GM2 times VGS2 that is equal to 0. Now if these two MOSFETs are perfectly matched, then this GM1 should be equal to GM2, right? Let's say that is equal to GM. So in that case, we can write this expression as GM times this VGS1 plus VGS2 that is equal to 0. Now since the transconductance of the MOSFET cannot be 0, so we can say that this VGS1 plus VGS2 has to be 0. That means this VGS1 is equal to minus VGS2. Let's say this is the equation number 2. Now here, since these differential inputs are complementary, so we can say that here this VID1 is equal to minus VID2. Let's say this is the equation number 3. So let us use these two results and let us put the value of these two results in the equation number 1. So we have seen that as per the equation number 1, this VID1 minus VID2 that is equal to VGS1 minus VGS2. So here, as per these two results, we can say that this VID1 minus VID1 that is equal to this VGS1 minus VGS1 that is equal to 2 times VID1 that is equal to 2 times VGS1. Or we can say that this VID1 is equal to VGS1. So earlier we have seen that this VX is equal to this VID1 minus VGS1. Now whenever this VID1 is equal to VGS1, so we can say that this VX is equal to 0. So from this we can say that for a small differential input, this node X will act as a ground, or equivalently it can also be drawn like this. So now because this node acts as a virtual ground, so we can treat the two parts of these circuits individually, and hence the analysis of this circuit becomes very easy. So here the current through this resistor RD is equal to ID1, or we can say that this output voltage VO1 is equal to minus ID1 times RD that is equal to minus GM1 times VGS1 times RD. Now as we have just seen, this VID1 is equal to VGS1. So from this we can say that this VO1 is equal to minus GM1 times RD times VID1. Similarly, for the second part, we can write this VO2 as minus GM2 times RD times VID2. And here, we are assuming that both MOSFETs are identical. That means here, this GM1 is equal to GM2. And let's say that is equal to GM. So we can say that this VO1 is equal to minus GM times RD times VID1, while this VO2 is equal to minus GM times RD times VID2. That means VO1 minus VO2 is equal to minus GM times RD times this VID1 minus VID2. Or we can say that this VO1 minus VO2 divided by VID1 minus VID2 that is equal to minus gm times rd. So here, this is the ratio of the differential output to the differential input, or in other words, it represents the differential gain of this differential amplifier. So we can say that this term is nothing but the differential gain. That means the differential gain of this differential amplifier is equal to minus gm times rd. So in this way, using the small signal analysis, we found the gain of this differential amplifier. Now, so far in our discussion, we have neglected the effect of the channel and modulation. That means we have assumed that this lambda is equal to 0. But when this lambda is non-zero, or with the finite channel and modulation coefficient, the output resistance of the MOSFET will also come into the picture. So in such case, if we see the small signal equivalent circuit, then it will look like this. Now here, due to the symmetry, these output resistance R01 should be equal to R02. Let's say that is equal to R0. So in that case, this R0 will be in parallel with the RD. And therefore, in that case, this differential gain will be equal to minus gm times this RD parallel R0. And of course, here due to the symmetry, we have assumed that this gm1 is equal to gm2. That means that including the effect of the channel and modulation, this will be the expression of the differential gain. Alright, so now so far in our discussion, we have assumed that both MOSFETs are identical and this current source is also ideal. But even with these ideal assumptions, the gain of this differential amplifier used to be very low. So let us take one example, and through that example, let us understand why the gain of this differential amplifier is very low. So in this example, this differential amplifier is biased with 0.8 milliampere current, and here the two MOSFETs are identical. And these are the device parameters of two MOSFETs. So here, with the help of these parameters, we will find the differential gain of this amplifier. Now here, since we have been given this early voltage, it means that these MOSFETs have the finite output resistance. And as we have seen, with the finite output resistance, this differential gain of this amplifier can be given as minus gm times this RD parallel R0. So here, the value of RD is already known. That means the only thing that we need to find is the value of this gm and the R0. So first of all, let us find the value of this output resistance. So as you know, in general, this output resistance of the MOSFET can be given as this VA divided by ID, where the VA is the early voltage and the ID is the drain current. So here, this ID is the bias current of these MOSFETs. So for this MOSFET M1, this R01 will be equal to this VA divided by ID1, while similarly, for the second MOSFET, this R02 is equal to VA divided by ID2. So here, this ID1 and the ID2 are the drain currents of these two MOSFETs under the equilibrium condition. So as we have seen in the earlier videos, under the equilibrium condition, when the differential input is zero and only common mode input is present, at that time, due to the symmetry of the circuit, this 0.8 milliampere current will get equally divided between the two MOSFETs. That means here, this ID1 is equal to ID2 is equal to 0.4 milliampere. And here, we already know the value of this early voltage. And therefore, this R01 is equal to R02, that is equal to 20 volt divided by 0.4 milliampere, which is equal to 50 kilo ohm. That means here, the output resistance of these two MOSFETs is equal to 50 kilo ohm. And let's call it as R0. So similarly, now let us find the transconductance. So as you know, this transconductance GM can be given as square root of 2 times ID times mu n times Cox times this W divided by L. So here, this GM1 is equal to GM2. So in general, let's call it as GM. Now here, this ID1 and the ID2 are 0.4 milliampere. Moreover, we have been also given the values of this mu n times Cox as well as the W by L. So here, this W by L is 20 while this mu n times COx is equal to 0.2 milliampere per volt square. So with the help of it, we can find the value of this transconductance. That means here, this Gm is equal to square root of 2 times 0.4 milliampere times 0.2 milliampere per volt square times 20. That is equal to 1.788 milliampere per volt. So in this way, we got the value of this transconductance as well as the output resistance. So we know that this differential gain can be given as minus Gm times this RD parallel R0. That is equal to minus 1.788 times this 5 kilo ohm in parallel with 50 kilo ohm. Now this parallel combination is equal to 4.55 kilo ohm. That means this differential gain is equal to minus 1.788 times this 4.55 kilo ohm. That is equal to minus 8.13. So here this negative sign indicates that this differential output is 180 degree phase apart from the differential input. But if we just consider the magnitude, then roughly we can say that this differential gain is equal to 8. So as you can see, for this differential amplifier, this differential gain is very low. So now let us see how we can improve this differential gain. So as per the equation, this differential gain can be given as this Gm times this RD parallel R0. So if you want to improve the differential gain, then either we need to increase the value of this drain resistor or we need to improve the transconductance. So if we increase the value of this drain resistor, then for the given bias current, the drop across this resistor will also increase. That means now the voltage which is available at the drain terminal will also reduce. So to keep the MOSFET in the saturation, we need to increase this supply voltage. And nowadays, since the integrated circuits are operating at the low voltages, so it is not always possible to increase the supply voltage. That means it is not possible to increase the value of this drain resistor beyond the certain limit. Now the second way is, if we increase the value of this transconductance, then also we can improve the gain. So as we have seen, this transconductance Gm can be given as square root of 2 times ID times this mu n times COx times W divided by L. So as per this equation, we can increase the transconductance either by increasing this drain current or by increasing the W by L ratio. So to increase the drain current, we need to increase this bias current. But as we increase the bias current, then the power consumption of the circuit will also increase. Moreover, with the increase in the bias current, the drop across this drain resistor will also increase. And hence, to keep the MOSFETs in the saturation, we also need to increase the supply voltage. So overall, by increasing the biasing current, the power consumption of the circuit will increase. Therefore, to keep the power consumption in the certain limit, the bias current of the circuit cannot be increased beyond the certain limit. Then the second way is, by increasing the W by L ratio, we can also increase the transconductance. And in a way, we can also increase the differential gain. But as we increase the W by L ratio, then the overall area which is occupied by the amplifier will also increase. So because of all these reasons, the transconductance of the MOSFET cannot be increased beyond the certain limit. So all these factors restricts the gain of this differential amplifier. So in the next video, we will see that how we can increase the gain of this differential amplifier. And we will also see how to design the high gain differential amplifiers. But I hope in this video, you understood how to find the gain of this differential amplifier using the small signal analysis. So if you have any question or suggestion, then do let me know here in the comment section below. If you like this video, hit the like button and subscribe to the channel for more such videos.